the car together. And when you think about the individuals affected by that, the workers, that's a big shock. That's a big disturbance in their lives.
I think that's right. So and I think the distinction that you've made there is an important one, which is really there are two worries we might have about technology in the labor market. One is a sort of a frictional unemployment, that where technology displaces people from the work they do, there's work elsewhere in the economy, but people might not have the skills and capabilities to move seamlessly across the economy to take up those other types of work. So someone displaced from a car manufacturing plant might not be able to learn the skills and capabilities required outside the plant to do a different job in the amount of time that they have. It just might not be possible. But then there's a more troubling argument, which is suppose people could learn any skill and capability under the sun in an instant, might there still not be enough work for them to do, even if they could learn to do anything? And that's a more, that's not strict frictional, that's a sort of structural problem of technological unemployment. And it's not something I think that we see yet. I think most of the worries that we have at the moment are not that there's not enough work for people to do, but it's that there's a mismatch. We don't have the skills and capabilities to move from occupation.
Yeah, and when people think of the overall picture, well, those professions will disappear, but new ones will be created. Yeah, maybe, but not for that same person. A guy who is 50 years old working in a car factory, and now there's a robot doing his job.
Yeah.
He's not going to learn to be a health worker.
So that is, I think, one way of thinking about it, which is that there might be jobs for health workers out there, but that person working in the plant simply isn't able to learn, for whatever reason, the skills and capability.
We have a couple of questions that came from the public in Brazil that our colleagues over there consulted.
Como é que você vê essa nova relação entre pessoas, empregadores, entre governos e essa nova força de trabalho que chega, talvez de uma maneira muito mais informal e fluida de ver o trabalho?
In the professions, the way we think about it, the way we talk about it, we say we've struck a grand bargain. The grand bargain is this arrangement that we've struck with the professions and we've struck with the state. And that grand bargain, which we can see from the 20th century, even in the 19th century in some cases, is being frayed and starting to become unstuck through these technological changes. And I think in many settings, we need to revisit that grand bargain, revisit those relationships. And it won't simply be between employees and employers or between employees and employers and the state. There are relationships, I think, across the economy that have been challenged by these new technologies.
Easier replacement is just purely manual work. That's easy to replace with robots. Those will probably go quicker, sooner.
One of the paradoxes in artificial intelligence is that actually some of the things that human beings find simplest to do with their hands are the most complicated to get machines to do. Conversely, some of the things that human beings find most complicated to do with their heads are the easiest.